Podcast book tours can be a great way to let people know about your new work. But one of the things we found out over the last 6 years, helping hundreds of authors, is that nonfiction books do much, 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 much better than fiction books. Let me explain why. You see, we focus on return on investment. Return on investment, not only of your time, but also the money that you invest with us. And one of the things that we've seen is that podcasts are ideal for relationships, not necessarily transactions. Now, what does this mean to the author? If you have a book and it's a one-time thing, all the people can do to interact with you is buy that one book. It's going to be really tough for them to build that relationship just to buy one book. And the value you get back from it is going to be limited. So, for example, talked to a prospect the other day. I'm excited to read his book. It's a fiction book about military history and the Bermuda Triangle and other things in there. It sounds very, very interesting, you know, sort of a little bit like Tom Clancy. He's put a lot of time, a lot of effort into this. He wants to get the book out there. But as I looked about it from podcasts, I was like, okay, what audiences would you be going after? It'd be going after a very, very small niche that would be interested in that. Probably a smaller niche would be interested in reading it. And especially with fiction, it's harder to do an audible book because now you need actors, voice actors to put the whole story together. So he wasn't planning on bringing out an audible book with it. So now you've got people that are already self-identified as audible listeners, and you're asking them to buy a book and read it. And even if they say yes, you'll probably make $2 from every book. By the time you figure out the time to prepare for it, to do the interview, that's a lot of work for a little reward that comes out of that. Another example, we had a prospect that came to us a while back, and she had a great cookbook. She had a beautiful cookbook that she wanted to talk about the recipes. But when we looked at it, the website really wasn't that strong. There was nothing else that she was offering at the time. And we talked to her about it and said, wow, you know, if you had more programs that you could do, if you had more things that you could refer to bring them back, and you'd probably get a whole lot better out of it. So sure enough, she came back to us about a year later and she said, now I'm ready to go. And now she has a fantastic cookbook. She's also got a fantastic website, fantastic Instagram where she can send people back to for pictures. She's got some courses, online courses. She's got a challenge that she can put people into. She's got a cleanse that she goes through with people. So she's got so many things that if they say yes, they can engage with her. And one of the things that we've seen in podcast interviews is people will engage with you at different levels. You know, there'll be the small yes where I want to check it out. I want to go back to your website and look at something. The medium yes, especially for authors, can be, I want to buy the book. I want to download the audio book. I want to buy the real book. I want to buy the workbook that goes with it. Then the heck yes is like, wow, I love what this person is saying. I can't wait to buy the book, read the book. And then what else is there? You see, that's why nonfiction books seem like they have worked best for us, because there's typically the book itself, then there's a business behind it. And that business could be consulting. Maybe talked with somebody the other day that had a brand consulting business. His book was to talk about why he thought you should have an indispensable brand, why branding was so vital, especially now. It was his point of view to put out there. So now he's going to go on a podcast interview, talk about his point of view. People will say, yes, I want to work with this guy, maybe come straight there. If they're slower, they may say, hey, I want to check out his book. I want to read that, understand who he is a little bit more. But his ultimate goal is not the book. Other ones will say, well, I'm hoping that they buy the book, but then also bring me in for a keynote speech, bring me in for consulting or workshops, bring me in for a virtual event. So the podcast interview leads to following things. Often, I think it was Brendan Burchard was the first one I heard talk about it. He talked about the value pyramid. So down at the very bottom of the pyramid might be something free, you know, just the podcast, the interview. And then you take them up a little bit further to a low cost item. And that could be the book. Then it could be a higher cost item, the course, masterminds, your consulting, one-on-one training, wherever that is, giving people the opportunity to say, yes, yes, yes. It's hard to do that with fiction, especially when you figure how much time and effort goes into a fiction book and knowing that even if they love you, they're going to have to wait for another couple of years to get the next book in that series. So that's one of the reasons when we talk with potential authors, we focus on what their potential return on investment could be of their time and their money. At the end of the day, we don't want another client. We want another raving fan. And so that's often we go through and say, can you get the expected return on investment from that? Something to think about. If you want more information about doing podcast book tours, about whether or not podcast interview marketing might work for you, you can go to the website podcastbooktours.com. There's some extra training and material there. There's an assessment that you can take to see if podcast interviews might be a great way for you to grow your brand, grow your business, and promote your book.